I'd like to get a fresh start on this year by dredging up some stale old crap from last year. Taking a look back at the painfully lazy and uncritical Newsnight piece, talking to the Twitter trolls and those who study them. Newsnight has handed the threat narrative hook of Twitter troll rape threats and explicit imagery that we, redacted, pixelated, or otherwise, don't get to see. They deliver a big heart-shaped box of Panda bonbons to those delicate fainting types who demand being shielded, regardless of the cost to anyone else, from comment, criticism, sarcasm, much-needed mockery, and cruelly withheld unconditional acceptance.
Remember, you're fighting for this woman's honor, which is probably more than she ever did.
In the community of atheists and skeptics, we're all too familiar with this ploy, and the dumbing down of the community to the point of massive brainstem failure by an influx of woo-peddling carpetbaggers who want to turn the once fruitful pursuit of the lack of belief in deities and evaluating claims solely on the basis of empirical methods and common sense into an endless referendum on their preoccupation with self and their pet sexual obsessions. And so what was atheism and skepticism becomes a game of gotcha with ever-changing rules of pronouns, the crisis of gender binaries, bogus accusations, an email of an email of an email by a friend of a friend accusing a prominent skeptic of serial rape that has all the substance of what, in less enlightened times, was referred to as Chinese whispers. Plus some arm flapping over t-shirts and photoshops and the completely unanticipated and baffling problem of guys on buses finding Jen McCrite simply irresistible. Most of this is as relevant to atheism and skepticism as a mob of grandmothers swarming a pool hall and demanding everyone start knitting. Which conveniently serves the purpose to decapitate any sane leadership in the community, hamstringing anyone who actually does anything like, say, atheism and skepticism. We're just supposed to hand it keys and all over to the miserable, clueless social justice wannabes who approach activism as if it were a text-based role-playing game for those too socially inept to get a quest going in World of Warcraft. Now, the Newsnight piece is mercifully short, just a 5-minute hammer space of bottomless bullshit. So let's try this. We'll go through it once to test just how much of the fair use provision of the Copyright Act of 1976 is still observed, and then, assuming DMCA notices don't come crashing down around us like cluster bombs, I'll go back over the bits that stick out and, for the purpose of comment, criticism, and education, be mean to them.
Since high-profile British women got hit with rape threats on Twitter, many of us have seen our timelines filled with shocking abuse and imagery, prompting a very practical question. Just what do you do if your internet timeline on social media gets suddenly swamped by people threatening rape or using extreme imagery of sexual violence? And who are they? I've been talking to the trolls, to people who've studied them, and to those trying to come up with a technical solution. Quinn Norton is a US journalist who's studied the trolls and been harassed by them. She thinks demands for Twitter to suspend the accounts just won't work.
It is easy enough, with a fairly basic understanding of programming, to auto-generate tons of accounts endlessly. And there isn't really a good way of stopping that. There are so many tools for getting around all the ways you can stop that, that the best thing to do is to let them have their account and to block that account so that you don't see it. Because if you remove that account, they're motivated to come back 10,000-fold.
When I showed her some of the abusers on my timeline, though we work on different continents, she recognized two immediately as part of a hardcore that had harassed her, prompting the question, why not ban them?
The social problem is that men are raised to hate women. And technology is not going to fix that. What's going to fix that is a societal conversation about why that is and why it shouldn't be.
Today, I was contacted by one of the people involved in directing hardcore rape jokes at women. I'd got it wrong, they said. I asked, what is the motivation?
Laughs.
I've been on here since the year dot and never been seriously griefed, so why so many women targeted?
Because women are easy. They get butt hurt so easy and react. If they don't react, nobody flames. It's that simple. People target feminazis because they're incredibly hypocritical and full of bullshit.
Is there a political agenda?
It's for laughs, not for a political cause. If the bitch had just blocked and moved on, nobody would have cared.
But there are tech solutions. Blogger Rebecca Watson had a bad experience at a conference 2 years ago.
4 a.m. I said, you know, I've had enough, guys, I'm exhausted, going to bed. So I walked to the elevator and a man got on the elevator with me and said, don't take this the wrong way, but I find you very interesting and I would like to talk more. Would you like to come to my hotel room for coffee? Just a word to the wise here, guys, don't do that.
For saying this, she was deluged with abuse on Twitter. In response, her supporters set up a program that monitors and blocks a shared list of abusers. And the man who wrote it talked me through the installation. I'll just block the super slimy.
The worst, yeah.
The worst. Let's do it. The block bot works by blocking a list of offenders that is constantly updated by a community. It uses Twitter's own technology, and that prompts another question. Why don't Twitter just implement what you've done as part of Twitter?
A good question. They certainly could do quite easily. They've got shared lists for following people. They could quite easily have the ability that people could create shared lists for blocking people as well. That would be possible. As I say, they're quite slow changing their platform, and as an IT person, I understand why. You know, in terms of keeping stability and the cost of doing that, they've got to be very careful that they maintain the service.
Those who've been around a long time can remember when the whole internet was predominantly male, and there are some social media sites now openly struggling to be representative.
Well, I mean, if you look at other online communities like Reddit, it's almost predominantly white male, young white males, and that's it. There's no marginalised groups left. There's a considerable lack of women, considerable lack of people of colour.
Why?
You know, these voices don't get heard. I'd guess, and I'll probably get completely flamed for this, but there's a whole load of abuse there. There's racist abuse there, there's homophobic abuse there, there's misogynistic abuse there. Why, if you're a woman, would you want to go somewhere where you get demeaned and put down because you're a woman?
For Twitter, which has seemed slow to act in this crisis, there's an existential question, and it's got nothing to do with this or that blocking mechanism. It is, quite simply, are they prepared to see their part of cyberspace become essentially white and male? For a company set to take $1 billion next year, driven by advertising, that is quite a question.
They truly hit the useful idiot jackpot in the form of Paul Mason, an old shoe scold who could glum the sparkle off a diamond. Then Newsnight's economics editor, of all things, he was able to parlay his rebranding as an expert in all things internet and rapey into a gig with Channel 4 as their culture and digital editor. Now, a bit of a rule of thumb here. Whenever you see a cutesy graphic like this through the back of the transparent monitor bit that adds nothing, is intended to give the impression that some plotting ludite is more tech-savvy than they really are, you're getting the feedback of computer-related threats that are either vastly overstated or mostly non-existent. If you're lucky, you'll get a phrase like,
"It's a Unix system.
Paired with computers doing what computers don't do and cool CGI velociraptors. If you aren't lucky, you'll get some cosmetology training dummy from 24/7 shit to worry about news, warning you that if hackers and trolls partnered in 4chan, they could use this cyberspace thingamajig to hack into our plumbing intertubes and end civilization as we know it by making all of our toilets flush at the same time. Anyway, Mason gives a disapproving look here. Do you think he's reading one of those rape threats he's heard so much about, or merely pretending to read one of those rape threats he's heard so much about for our benefit? I don't know. Maybe that's just his face clenching. What we do know is we're not reading one of those rape threats we've heard so much about. In his old gig as economics editor, Mason must have a lot of expertise in fudged facts, poorly sourced baffle gab, and underpants gnome-level magical thinking. Unfortunately, based on watching him in action and how economists operate, his expertise must be in swallowing it whole. Now, here's a question. Why Twitter? No, really, what is it about Twitter, a medium of 140 characters or less, that lends itself to little more than banter and short-form dumb, that makes it the preferred tool of people usually found chanting, hey, hey, ho, ho, something or other has got to go, while sticking it to the man by banging on a spackle bucket? How is Twitter going to raise our paradigms down to their corrupt foundations through a ticker tape of arguing on the internet? Why has Twitter become the last stand hill against the entrenched invisible hand of the patriarchy, cis-normatives going about their business, and the coming troll apocalypse? Twitter obviously appeals to those people with short attention spans and superficial activists who think in bumper sticker deepity. Some people are just attracted to simple and short solutions to complex problems, especially when the problem can be blamed on someone else and so requires nothing but self-righteous sloth on the part of the activist. This explains the appeal for both social justice wankers and Tea Party dumbfucks, at least among those members who can figure out how to use the internet. In that regard, there's not a whole hell of a lot of difference between people who blame their bad hair day on the patriarchy and those who think Ron Paul is right-wing Jesus and so the answer to everything. People who think Twitter is a tool of social change include, and are no different from, stupid girl fashionista feminists whose ideological depth runs no deeper than sporting a pair of hipster glasses, dyeing their hair a color not found in nature, an afternoon shopping at Granny's consignment shop, and a narcissistic certainty that justice is all about getting things their way all the time, even if their way now is vastly different from their way as of 30 seconds ago. All of which is a great reason for people you don't know, but know of you, to call you an asshole on Twitter. So if your whole shtick is to claim you're in the right simply because people are being mean to you, mean in the special professional victim sense of people who don't roll over and submit to your every whim, then the format of Twitter is perfect for generating bite-sized little bits of mean, stripped of context and sharpened by brevity. That's what suits the needs of thin-skinned megalomaniacs driven mad by the authoritarian mindset that all discourse, especially everyone else's, must serve their agenda and their agenda alone. If it doesn't, it's not just wrong, but it must be prohibited outright. Still, sometimes it just doesn't look right to prohibit dissent on its own merits, and so disagreement has to be distorted, misrepresented as something else, the dissenter smeared by outright fabrication. Keep in mind the threat narrative cultivated by shameless grifters like Anita Sarkeesian.
Because it's basically a choose-your-own-patriarchal adventure porno fantasy.
That provides a nice distraction from the fact she kick-started her way to riches, raking in donations to buy and play video games for cutting-edge analysis, and all anyone has to show for it is this.
Somehow people, stupid people, managed to donate $150,000 to this woman who doesn't even list her sources academically or where she's got them, but she doesn't even give credit to the people whose videos that she took without their permission, without giving them credit for their videos that they made, which not only that, but she hasn't even played the games that she's actually listing. Anita was going on a blocking spree. In fact, she recently blocked me from her Facebook page for bringing this up.
So it's completely in her most self-serving interest, not to mention the preservation of her con, to maintain a one-way flow of information. She talks, you listen. And disabling comments on her YouTube videos is all because those nasty trolls mean we can't have nice things. and not because of her blocking people simply because they point out she fleeced those who put their trust in her out of $100,000 or so. Paul Mason accepts this siege mentality tactic at face value. Sure, some women have had horrible things said to them on Twitter. As part of the subset of people who have had horrible things said to them on Twitter. People say all sorts of horrible things. Sexist things, racist things, anti-Semitic things, stupid things, wrong things. But also, people try to silence other people by claiming they say sexist, racist things. For every bona fide misogynistic comment, you'll have just as many fashionistas claiming merely disagreeing with them, regardless of the subject at hand, is tantamount to pathological hatred of all women. Some people will assert that unless you support everything Israel does down the line without question, then you are a born-again Einsatzgruppen. Wingnuts do it too. If you want your patriotism impugned, the fastest way is to disagree with the pet paranoia of some right-wing nut. People saying mean things to each other predates the internet and wasn't invented by trolls on Twitter. Look, here's the Venus of Willendorf, a small Paleolithic statuette presumed to represent some sort of fertility goddess. Then again, I claim it expresses the preliterate misogynistic concept, you look fat. That is, that's what I could claim if I were playing the stupid game of saying things to provoke a response I could then treat as an assault on my very person. The reason why accusations of misogyny, for example, are so effective in silencing critics is that rather than being a wildly sexist and patriarchal society that could give a fuck what women think and feel, we take these accusations seriously, and our reflex response is to do something about it, even if the woman in question is practiced at misrepresenting comments, criticism, and mockery as something else. By now, it's a tired old tactic for people to say provocative, even slanderous things in order to provoke a response that they can then complain about. That's especially true when the person making the accusation is, in fact, the one up to no good. When you're caught with your hand in the cookie jar, hell, you've got nothing to lose. Why not make a big show of claiming there's something pervy and objectifying about the person who caught you staring at your hand?
Just what do you do if your internet timeline on social media gets suddenly swamped by people threatening rape or using extreme imagery?
Paul Mason and Newsnight haven't done the bare minimum of background research to be aware of the history of goalpost shifting, convenient revisionism, outright lying, shameless hypocrisy, and con artistry among the very people providing information. Nor does he seem aware that the threat narrative is the clown car's first line of offense against truth tellers. Or maybe, and I find this very likely, he just doesn't care. Before we get to Newsnight's parade of bullshit artists, let's have a little report on the intersectionality between batshit hysterical news and their counterparts in cynical threat narrative clickbait horseshit.
This is Walter Cronkite in our newsroom, and
back before the internet and back before the gaping abyss of 24/7 cable news, reporting the news on TV was seen as a public service, or at least part of the cost of maintaining one's broadcast license. News didn't make money and was allotted a set time to tell you those things considered important enough to be news. This golden era is referred to by program planners and marketing people as the era when no one knew what in fuck they were doing. Of course, the marketing people and program planners know exactly what they're doing. Just ask them when they're making toast in the bathtub. And although cable news came in with a superficial resemblance to the earlier model of network news, it wasn't long before the news became just another form of entertainment. The purpose of entertainment is to transfix eyeballs to the screen and sell the people attached to them shit they don't need. In doing so, selling the news was far more important than telling the news. If what was news wasn't entertaining enough, there were hyperactive sprinting toupees taking it to the air and action news choppers, because after all, what better place to bring you the issues that matter to you than from a couple of thousand feet in the air? Newsrooms became like high-tech Las Vegas battle stations, not to bring you the news, but to give the impression of frantic activity hiding the journalistic sloth behind it all. And also, people could sell you shit you don't need, make you feel inadequate if your friends and neighbors had more or better shit they don't need, or if they got their shit they don't need before you got your shit you don't need. Advertising specializes in making up shit for you to need, creating the very problems their products miraculously solve. And so did the news, once everyone got confused as to what was advertising, what was journalism, and who was selling what to whom. Many people mistake all this for a political agenda on the part of the news channels, but really, it's all too dumb to be political propaganda. It's just marketing. It may be that Fox News is selling the Republican Party, but the Republican Party is pretty much owned by people who aspire to nothing more than selling you shit you don't need. It works like this. Let's say you had a road in the middle of nowhere. The road goes nowhere, and nothing of significance has happened on that road in the time it took to lay down a half foot of windblown dust. Now, stick a box on the side of the road. Nothing special about it, it's just a box. A casual observer, were there one, might wonder what was in the box. Maybe it's full of money or dope, puppies or kittens. If it was owned by Greta Christina, it could contain some old prescription Fluvox. More than likely, the box, like most discarded boxes, is simply empty. A reasonable guess as to what's in the box would range from nothing bad to nothing at all. Now, bring in some cable news outfit and their army of professional hysterical douchebags, and that otherwise innocuous box will take on a decidedly ominous cast. A photogenic blonde hand puppet can talk about what, if any, potential threat the shoebox represents to you and yours, and what can be done about it, because, damn it, something should be done about it. Hours of not-so-important space between all-important advertising can be filled by clucking and braying Hollywood squares of reliable talking heads who, with the utter conviction of people who have no idea what they're talking about, whose expertise is based entirely on having seen a shoebox once without knowing they, in general, contain shoes, can take a hard line against those godless, life-hating bastards who wish us harm by leaving shoeboxes by the side of the road. This can go on for hours of cheap, content-free television. The point is to create an inclusive, safe space where people who count, by virtue of being on television, can feel free to completely lose their shit over nothing without fear of contradiction, and where they can all join together in worst-case scenario solidarity like a big clenched asshole waiting for the worst. Time anyone figures out there was nothing in the box, and before anyone can learn a thing from it, they've all moved on to the next big important thing, such as the dangers of anal bleaching amongst silicon-based life forms.
Lesbian Nazi hookers abducted by UFOs and forced into weight loss programs. All this week on Town Talk.
Internet clickbait fueled by the threat narrative works pretty much the same way. It's mostly content-free hysteria, and as a form of marketing, its purpose is to sell you shit, fear and loathing, that you don't need. Blogs and aggregate sites are fueled by clickbait. Sometimes it's obvious, as with those little thumbnail blurbs luring you in with which celebrity has a baby bump and why this smiling asshole has a secret that makes diet doctors hate him. Some sites, such as the Huffington Post, make editorial decisions based on which link will make your click finger the most itchy. For clickbaiters, it doesn't matter if they embarrass themselves with the shamelessness of their bait, or if they turn off sensible readers with headlines about someone slamming someone else when a reading of the article contains nothing of the sort. Once that link is clicked, they can give a fuck what you think of them. Outfits like Freethought Blogs, for example, for all their posturing, works the same way. PZ Myers will continue to write dumb, poorly thought out, and hypocritical shit as long as people pay attention to him for writing dumb, poorly thought out, and hypocritical shit. When he published a moral humble-bragging blog post accusing Michael Shermer of being a serial rapist, his first thought wasn't in doing the right thing, assuming he still has dim memories of what that is like, but because it was guaranteed to get a lot of hits, comments, and attention. The most important link on Freethought Blogs is the one inviting advertisers on Freethought Blogs. Not to say they're lining up. What's behind their eggshell-thin moralizing is just marketing. Content doesn't matter, which is why someone like Ophelia Benson can have a blog post catalog that consists of 95% copying and pasting someone else's opinion with just enough text inserted into the cracks, no doubt written on a Ouija board, to give the impression she was awake for it. In no time at all, threat narrative clickbait horseshit isn't just something a person does. It's a way of life. Easier if one is predisposed to manipulation and drama in one's personal life. All interactions serve the purpose of the care and feeding of the drama, enforcing medieval morality play archetypes of good and evil, sin and virtue, and generally stirring up shit. When it comes to mean comments, even mean-spirited trolling, the question is not whether some people have it coming, because some people most certainly do, and by their own design. It's what the sort of person given to poking hornets' nests with sticks should be exempt from getting stung, and whether the sort of person who dedicates themselves to flinging shit at other people can then turn around and complain about being bothered by flies. Skill at playing this sad, stupid game often determines who gets on the victim parade of convention speaking gigs and panel discussions, which are often nothing more than the threat narrative clickbait horseshitter recounting their adventures in martyrdom on the internet. And that, rather than doing atheism or skepticism or knowing something about anything, is what establishes them in the pecking order of neurotic basket cases and con artist scumbags. Let's have a look at Paul Mason's first expert in misogynistic rape-threatening trolling, Quinn Norton. Just to show how serious all this is, Mason quits playing with his computer and relocates to a place with more gravitas, where he can get to the bottom of this crisis in trolling while inconveniencing people trying to get to the stairs.
The social problem is that men are raised to hate women, and technology is not going to fix that. What's going to fix that is a societal conversation about why that is and why it shouldn't be.
Let's run that again.
The social problem is that men are raised to hate women.
That Mason lets her get away with saying something so stupid isn't much of a surprise with him in full pander mode. That, and maybe Paul Mason could be beat at Jeopardy by Wolf Blitzer.
The day is mine!
You might think he might ask just who are these people raising men to hate women. I mean, gee, thanks, Mom. What is impressive is the transparent shamelessness of Quinn Norton. She's just trying to make a point here, but the point of saying men are raised to hate women is just verbal clickbait. She's just advertising her availability to say stupid, contentious, clickbaity things at your next speaking gig. Some background. Paul Mason presents Quinn Norton as a journalist, a term that resonates with a history of quixotic, ink-stained alcoholism performed in service of the public's right to know. What Norton does, as far as I can tell, is write some odd, self-absorbed, blog-quality shit for Wired magazine. The latest issue of Wired, fresh from the supermarket, found between the restrained council of handgun magazines and periodicals dedicated to getting you totally ripped summer abs, whether you want them or not. This month's Wired has a special report, how the U.S. almost killed the internet, and why it still could. Why? In a fit of pique over a big chunk of the NSA's budget being blown, compiling and archiving what turned out to be P.Z. Meyer's tentacle rape porn collection. That would be my guess. We need a term for the kind of tree extinction level pulp clickbait found in supermarkets. Half of them have covers with one or more of the Kardashians. The others tease with circular inset photos of bad beach booty as big and shapeless as a rogue weather balloon, and you're supposed to guess which celebrity they belong to. Hint, it's one or more of the Kardashians. And then there are those like Wired warning of the coming digital apocalypse, which, as with all apocalypsi, could be a good thing, provided it killed the Kardashians. Quinn Norton's other claim to journalistic integrity comes from having written dispatches while embedded with the Occupy movement. If we use the embedding of reporters with U.S. forces in Iraq as an example of how this works, then perhaps it isn't something they should be bragging about. At least reporters in Iraq got to ride on Humvees and watch shit get blown up.
Hell yeah, bitches!
All Quinn Norton got to do was hang out with the Occupy social justice elite who, if DC was typical, led from the rear, showed up in the camps to briefly blow some hot air before fucking off elsewhere, or, if they were really slumming it, they held court in the nearest Starbucks. I'm sure her experience with embedding was quite different than mine. I froze my ass off with the homeless. I tried to spread the gospel of the tautline hitch to those trying to keep their tarps from flapping in the breeze, and I personally suffered the torture of 1 a.m. drum circles. Seriously, guys, it's 1 in the morning. Shut the fuck up. Yeah, I've covered what went down at Occupy DC in my previous video, the raging vibrator of death that introduced Mikeru's Law. For me, Occupy was like a disillusioned expat's final verdict on Paris. A thing beautiful in anticipation, full of promise, but in execution, like a tub of assholes. That disparity can be expressed as Mikeru's second law, whereby all movements, and this is especially true of social reform movements, begin in well-intentioned necessity, but end as ruthless con jobs. Still, it could have been worse. It could have been Vancouver. It's one thing to label all critics as rape-threatening trolls in order to block them from the last best hope for humanity, Twitter. But you have to hand it to Occupy Vancouver, taking it to the next step after the Pabst Blue Ribbon Beer Hall Putsch, as short as I can make it. Infighting, power struggles, and the mundane accusation that some Occupy higher-ups were abusing their power. Not surprisingly, one of the guys doing much of the complaining also turns out to have been a, surprise, surprise, sexual harasser. They skipped the show trial and went straight for the public character execution, which also, and here's some problem solving for you, banished him from the Occupy movement. It all seems so familiar. Except this wasn't something played out in the abstract on the internet. This was a full-on, we've got a barn, let's put on a purge musical comedy. A circle of protection was formed around a pasty little administrator apparatchnik so he could slander the guy without fear of interruption. That circle looked a lot like a bunch of wannabe half-assed stormtroopers dressed in black, using black flags on staffs as riot batons to poke and intimidate anyone not going along with this teachable moment in the re-education camp. And Occupy Vancouver, good for them, wasn't aware or just didn't care how fascist it all looked. Now, the reason I bring this up in the context of Quinn Norton and her supposed reporting on Occupy is this. Abuses were rampant within Occupy, from the social justice nobility to the rank and file assholes. And I'm speaking here from the point of view of the truly disillusioned. It was a reform movement in serious need of reform, beginning with its own leader's staggering animal farm level hypocrisy. Norton, in a December 2012 piece, A Eulogy for Occupy, seems to make just that criticism of Occupy, but only superficially and only punching down, writing. Because the GA had no way to reject force, over time it fell to force. Proposals won by intimidation. Bullies carried the day. What began as a way to let people reform and remake themselves had no mechanism for dealing with them when they didn't. It had no way to deal with parasites and predators. It became a diseased process, pushing out the weak and quiet it had meant to enfranchise until it finally collapsed when nothing was left but predators trying to rip out each other's throats. Now, Quinn Norton gets the impression of a journalist blowing into Occupy for the big event clashes with the police, in fact, asking her editor to reimburse her for the purchase of a gas mask. She's so in the thick of it.
I thought everyone had their own gas mask.
Although she visits tents here and there, I doubt she stayed in one except for the purpose of self-conscious, I lived it reporting. In fact, her theory on the decline of Occupy swerves suspiciously close to claiming it was stabbed in the back by the little people, scumbags all, who refused to change for the better under the mentoring of the social justice nobility, who were just too nice for their own good. So it comes as no surprise that the narrative around Occupy becomes not systemic top-down abuses from the very people put in positions of trust, but the bubbling of muck from below, including the ever-present threat of misogyny in its multifaceted everything-counts form, and anything to do with sex, sexual harassment, and rape, however you're able to work it in. Watch here. In one of her speaking gigs, Quinn Norton is asked a question about the claims of sexual abuse within the Occupy movement.
Hi, my name's Megan. I work at Rabbit. I'm a little bit concerned with the way that Anonymous and the Occupy movement and like the protests in the Middle East and that sort of thing get kind of glorified. And a lot of the abuse that happens in those movements gets glossed over. Like, we know the government's bad, but these movements are not all good, and I think we're not doing enough criticism of these movements. Like, there were a lot of reports of sexual abuse coming out of the Occupy movement from, you know, these sort of figureheads who had been kind of glorified by the Occupy movement.
You would think for someone who claims men are raised to hate women, the answer would come easy, that Occupy is just as rapey top to bottom as every other group, or more to the point, Occupy guys are just as rapey as every other guy. So the circuitousness of the society's to blame answer puzzles me.
I have actually written extensively about the abusive environment in the Occupy in particular. And I do think this is one of the reasons why my caveat is these things are incompetent. We are not very good at this yet. You know, it wasn't just the abuses. It also like fell apart in a bunch of places. A lot of things in Anonymous and Occupy just fall over. You know, once the first wave of Arab revolutions was done, then it was like a vacuum. They didn't have anything more to say than we don't like you. And I think actually that's a symptom of it being very, very new. It isn't easy to criticize Occupy, in part because, like, at that moment when self-criticism would have started to be useful, they started getting massive evictions. And that's one of the reasons why, you know, my last exhortation is, let's make this a good thing. Because it could be really bad. Like, I can imagine a network collective ruling the planet which turns everything gray. And everyone who is different is immediately smashed and destroyed by that thing. I can imagine a dystopian thing that would make me long for the worst of the nation states. I would like that to not happen. I would like us to do better than that. But absolutely, these things are not to be idealized. Their methods can be fantastic, and they can have absolutely transcendent, wonderful moments, just as traditional institutions, which were, you know, only traditional for a couple hundred years before they were like the weird slime molds of their time, also have like beautiful ascendant moments where they put a man on the moon or start to enfranchise women and people of color, and then, you know, it's still made of humans in the end. We don't get away from that.
Oh, sorry. If anyone can figure out what all that big picture and hemming and hawing was about, please send your theories to Micromedia, International Center for Bullshit Studies, Rambling Crypto Babble Annex, Washington, D.C. After something like that, you might think you have no reasonable expectation of things getting any more entertaining, but as reasonable as that may be, you would also be very much mistaken. Following Norton's appearance on Newsnight, or more accurately, its dissemination via YouTube, Ryan Long on Twitter points out to Norton that the BlockBot list, far from being a penalty box or trollish men raised to hate women, actually contains a disproportionate number of women whose sole transgression was getting on the wrong side of the mean girl cliques of Atheism Plus, Freethought Blog, Skeptic, and the Center for Inquiry, who spend a whole lot of time advocating for women's voices, mostly by telling other women what to think and what to say. Long, who self-identifies as gay because, well, he is, gets a nasty, belittling response from Quinn Norton that would come across as just a hair on the wrong side of gay bashing had it not come from such a tireless champion of social justice such as herself. Norton, who claims to want to have societal conversations, gets on social media where people converse, and when she's questioned, she accuses people of not understanding context, and then, when that doesn't work, resorts to abuse herself, and dismisses the people having a conversation with her as wusses and pansy misogynists. What's equally entertaining is that somewhere in all this, Quinn Norton claims she has no idea what a BlockBot is, which means she had no clue on earth what they were talking about, but that didn't stop her from totally pegging them as pansy misogynists. Either she wasn't paying attention to what her talking head gig was all about, or Mason neglected to tell his expert what she was giving an expert opinion on. Maybe they just record these things as vague and loose as possible because you never know what topic you might want to splice Quinn Norton into. I could see why she rationalizes the sort of response she gets personally for her bullshit into a more palatable claim that men hate women, and why some men, having a societal conversation with a hypocritical clickbaiter like her, might end up disliking her. To put it all in context, what a cunt. Oh, one more thing I should add. Quinn Norton has written some cutting-edge tech stuff recounting her experiences as a cyborg. achieving this transhuman state by having a magnet surgically implanted in the tip of one of her fingers. Now, I didn't just make that up. I shit you not.
I'll just block the super slimy.
The worst, yeah.
The worst. Let's do it. The blockbot works by blocking a list of offenders that is constantly updated by a community.
Somewhere between being a cunt and a plain old asshole, which I guess makes him kind of a taint, is head script kitty James Billingham. Yeah, I know, that photo is juvenile and uncalled for, and I'll fix it immediately. There, that's more like it. Billingham is better known as Freethought Blog's resident sycophantic troll, operating under the name Ulan. Before revealing himself in this futile bid for respectability, there was speculation, mostly disinterested and clinical, as to whether Ulan was a small poodle using the keyboard to get an itch it couldn't scratch, an artificial intelligence virtual troll created by a programmer with excessively low expectations from humans, or simply a slimy turd shat directly into the vent of a personal computer. As to Billingham himself, I won't say much. Whether he's a troll, a Poe, or a true believer, what he is can best be described as relentlessly uninteresting. He doesn't have original thoughts or produce unique content. What he does do is repeat talking points more or less efficiently. Should you make a comment on a blog covering the Freethought blog drama of the day, you can then sit back and say 1-1000, 2-1000, 3-1000, and not get very far at all until old Uli shows up spouting the FTP party line, the entrenched lie, the canonical bullshit. Billingham has a 9/11 truther's stamina when it comes to injecting boilerplate nonsense into any online discussion. He's an otherwise empty vessel packed full of crap. The only interesting thing Billingham relates in his demonstration is not what he says, but in what he omits. The purpose of the blockbot is not, as you may be led to believe, so people can shield themselves from rape and death threats or other forms of unpleasantness. To whatever extent it allows some people to do so is simply cover for its main purpose. The blockbot allows thin-skinned ideologues to sandbag any comment or criticism that may be leveled against their own excesses and intolerance, while devoicing and dehumanizing anyone who disagrees with them. The purpose of claiming only the worst abusers get added to the blockbot list is a handy way to take perfectly justified criticism and mockery and roll it up with manufactured crisis of rape trolling. The blockbot was the next best idea when the in-beta testing OffenseBot 5000 turned so neurotic it cowered in a corner of its own partitioned-off hard drive and refused to come out unless its programmers typed pounce hugs until their fingers bled. Billingham's insinuation that the blockbot is used to filter out the slimiest is a creepy little dig at the slime pit forum. Ulan, as always, is parroting the official Freethought blog's echo chamber, which would have people believe the slime pit is a misogynistic hive of rape-joking dude bros. Revisionist history aside, the slime pit, so named to take ownership of a Freethought bully insult, was founded by virus-hugging researcher Abby Smith, she of the unfortunate screen cap, to directly oppose attacks by fashionista feminists, social justice wannabes, and authoritarian dimwits in general against those women who refused to toe their line. What Atheism Plus, Freethought Blog, Skeptic, and teary passive-aggressive factions within the Center for Inquiry think they're doing is anyone's guess, and they would be the last to know. the slime pit exists in part because some people in the skeptical community, despite the best efforts of agenda-driven pseudo-skeptics, don't shy away from doing skepticism. As those on the other side of the schism are clueless, hypocritical, mean-spirited, and thoroughly irrational clowns, that skepticism is often done with a big dollop of medicinal humor. If the definition of a Puritan is someone offended by the mere thought that someone somewhere might be having some fun, then the greatest sin of the slime pit isn't some wholly imagined hate speech. In the minds of these babbling, postmodern Puritan scolds, it's that we're having way too much fun. Of course, it's revealing of a mindset that's lacking in anything like a mind that they tend to dump ridicule in with rape threats in a great big shit bucket and slosh it around hoping no one can tell the difference. Now, Billingham just can't help himself. He has to get in his not-so-veiled reference to the slime pit, even if it's lost on Mason and his audience. The slime pit is a special obsession of freethought bloggers such as P.Z. Myers, and so it's an obsession of Ulan as well. Regardless of how a lazy crapmonger like Paul Mason presents him, Billingham is an expert in nothing, and his half-assed technical solution to the crisis of trolling simply piggybacks on existing Twitter anti-spam and terms of service protocols. Rather than being the independent effort of a disinterested party, it's a wholly owned tool of Atheism Plus and Freethought blogs, with their dishonest, controlling agenda built right in. The other thing that old Uli omits is that people don't just get added to the blockbot blacklist for being slimy, whatever the metric is for that. Although posting openly in the slime pit is a fast track to getting banned on freethought blogs, Atheism Plus forums, and added to the general blacklist, even that is a bit too restrained for rampant control freaks. One of the first acts carried out by those implementing the blockbot blacklist was to scour people's Twitter accounts to see who they were following. If someone was following the tweets of someone deemed the wrong sort of person, then the follower, without having done anything else, got added to the blacklist. Now think about that for a moment. Paul Mason just presented two supposed experts on internet trolls, graduates of their own Troll Independent Studies program. I assume they followed a troll or two, the real article, in their time, as it's a crap bird watcher who stares out their kitchen window for whatever happens to flap into the backyard. However, should you show the same initiative, keep tabs on what those rapey bastards are up to, provide early warning well before the great swarms of trolls darken the sky, you'd get added to the blockbot list yourself as, at the very least, a wrong-headed troll sympathizer, if not actually in league with the diabolical rape-threatening legion. Perhaps Quinn Norton and James Billingham had to apply for special permission to study trolls, sort of an Atheism Plus Soviet Academy system where, properly vetted for ideological purity and strength of character, they were determined to be the right sort of person to withstand the potentially corrupting influence of Twitter troll studies. Now, full disclosure here. From the inception of the blockbot, right at rollout, I found myself on level 2 of the blacklist. Not for making rape or death threats, although I enjoy that as much as the next guy, but for making the sort of videos you're watching right now, and for being a dreaded slime pitter. Considering the runny mashed potato minds of the people administering the blockbot, that didn't bother me. No, it was the outrage, the unforgivable slight that innocuous people pleaser like Justin Bekula placed above me in the roll call of infamy. What is it? It's a stash, isn't it? Now here's how the witch hunting works. My appearing on the blockbot blacklist gave license for a smug and laughably self-important douche like Chris Clark, who famously once took a moral stand, preemptively refusing convention speaking gigs if he didn't like anyone else on the lineup, when no one was asking him to speak, ever, gave him license to add me to a short list of rape supporters. Not rape apologists, mind you, bona fide rape supporters. Now, why does a nasty, self-aggrandizing, puffed-up shit nugget like Chris Clark consider me to be a rape supporter? I really have no idea. And neither does Chris Clark. I imagine it has something to do with the juxtaposition of my being branded a mediocre Twitter threat deserving of level 2, and rape being a general fixture of Chris Clark's fantastic mental landscape. Sort of like a Salvador Dali painting, with spooge. As the people running the blockbot have no need for any transparency in their decisions or provide any reasons, then pulling things straight from your ass, as Norton, Billingham, and Clark do, becomes what passes for a best practice. Later, I was promoted from level 2 on the blacklist to the coveted level 1 grade, the worst of the worst. Now, I like to think I got there through my own initiative and striving for excellence. However, just as I became a rape supporter for no other reason than I was listed on the blacklist, I suspect I was promoted to level 1 because, you guessed it, I was listed as a rape supporter. And around it goes. Anything not expressly forbidden is obligatory. Take heart, because we're in the home stretch. The journalistic low point of Paul Mason's No Stone Left Unturned, Left Unthrown Newsnight piece. His interview with a troll.
What is the motivation?
Laughs.
I've been on here since the year dot and never been seriously griefed, so why so many women targeted?
Because women are easy. They get butt hurt so easy and react. If they don't react, nobody flames. It's that simple. People target feminazis because they're incredibly hypocritical and full of bullshit.
Honestly, you gotta love the balls of this bit. The piss-poor Americanized accent that sounds like a 12-year-old on his first beer reading from a Jack the Ripper letter.
Mr. Lusk, sir, I send you off the kidney I took for one, preserved it for you. T'other piece I frawed and ate. It was very nice. I may send you the bloody knife that took it out, if you only wait a while longer. Catch me when you can, Mr. Lusk.
The uncertainty over who's taking the piss out of whom, leading to a potential infinite regress of cons, conning, cons, conning, cons. But in what school of journalism, or at least one room schoolhouse of tabloid dog shit that at least goes through the motions of being taken seriously, is this bit of pantomime in any way acceptable? We get feminazi bitches all butthurt for the lols. Seriously, just who in hell talks like that? No, not even me, that's who. Paul Mason's troll exclusive, even if you can set aside the ham-fisted voice acting and Along Came a Spider graphics, seems to have come straight from Threat Narrative Central casting, which of course, it did. Really, how do you figure Paul Mason came across as troll? Did he sit at the drugstore soda fountain looking for a troll to make a star? Cruise the M4 Trolls section of Craigslist? Loiter outside of Trolls R Us? Or did someone take his hand and lead him, blindfolded, into the secret world of trolls? I could just imagine Mason logging in, ready to throw some hard-hitting packing peanuts at the troll, while James Oolan the Slimy Turd Billingham rushed around outside the BBC Two studios looking for two things. An old-style telephone box to emerge from in his super troll costume, and an internet cafe that took loose change. As I mentioned, shortly after doing the story, Paul Mason went on to a bigger and better gig as Channel 4's digital and culture editor. Which means it's far too late for him to read the BBC's standards and practices regarding accuracy in reporting. Aside from all the old and busted media stuff about using first-hand sources and fact-checking, it specifically warns special care must be taken if we suspect material has been supplied by someone with a vested interest in the story rather than a disinterested bystander. Now, you can call Mason's supposed experts many things. Things that begin with fuck and end with wit immediately come to mind. But disinterested bystander isn't one of them. Remember Mason's starting premise that high-profile British women were under serious threat as opposed to for the lulz by Twitter trolls? First, Mason seems quite unaware, for a digital and culture editor anyway, of the origin and meaning of the term troll, which comes from fishing and means to throw out some contentious, perhaps offensive opinion in order to elicit a reaction. Perhaps nothing as contentious and offensive as men are raised to hate women, but then most amateur trolls lack the dedication of the professionals. Just to make it perfectly simple, you can't present your Exhibit A troll as motivated by doing it for the lulz, and then continue with the original assertion that this sort of trolling represents a legitimate threat. Once you reveal your troll as not being serious, regardless of what sort of juvenile little shit he might be, you can't have it both ways and claim this is something for a reasonable person to fear. Ah, but you say, all pedantic-like, even supposing mocking trolls, the trolling is still offensive to the person being trolled and serves no purpose but to harass, humiliate, and annoy. Fair enough. But before you stick with that opinion, mostly because you think it makes you sound morally elevated if not the only adult in the room, consider this fine bit of trolling, which serves to harass, humiliate, and annoy. Here we have a restaurant owner named Gary. Gary is Mr. We Reserve the Right to Refuse Service to Anyone. The article focuses on Gary being anti-gay, but to be fair, Gary is something of a Renaissance man when it comes to being against people and things. Here's one review of Gary and his establishment. Appalling, bigoted, discriminatory behavior is regularly displayed at this establishment. The owner, Gary James, refuses to serve wheelchair-bound persons, black people, Hispanics, mixed-race couples, gay people, people who wear hats, people who ask for Budweiser, liberals, men with longish hair, people wearing clothing he doesn't approve of, people with facial piercings, on and on ad nauseum. If you pass first inspection, don't think you've got it made. If he doesn't approve of an overheard conversation, if he decides you're too effeminate, if your politics don't agree with his, if you don't like the way your steak is cooked, if you cheer for the wrong team, etc., etc., Mr. James will charge you more for your meal. After word of Gary James' style of restaurant management and social engineering got out, there was a run on his restaurant's Yelp and Facebook pages. Typical of these reviews is this. I don't quite understand the negative reviews. Glory Hole Gary, as he's known around these parts, provides the best French fry grease hand jobs this side of Tulsa. Stop in on Tuesdays for the tenderloin and tug lunch special, and every day from 5 p.m. to 8 p.m. for Gary's $3 beer and blow happy hour. There's lots more of these sort of reviews. Ever-growing, and each one more entertaining than the last. Like it or not, Gary may have the choice of being the most fabulous gay bar in the area, or abandoned. Does that bother me? Not at all. I think it's fucking great. And so do you. People are shocked, simply shocked, to find out there's trolling going on, except, of course, when it's directed at someone they find to be a deserving target. Then, it's not trolling at all, with its negative connotations of Cheeto eating and basement dwelling. No, it becomes karma, direct action, or, to coin a phrase, social justice. While I have no sympathy at all for a stain on humanity like Gary James, I have no more sympathy for a nasty bit of work like Melody Hensley, whose self-promoted and ridiculous claims of Twitter-induced post-traumatic stress disorder was a result of people pushing back against her for spending lots of time on social media saying nasty things about other people, notably bitchy and belittling things about other women. We can dispense with Mason's laughable and highly suspect central casting troll and celebrate the lighthearted, nautical, and socially useful roots of trolling.
Oh, fucked up.
That I referenced a vision of hair dye and disdain like Chanty Binks is no accident. Binks became a minor internet sensation and meme for our time after a video of her arguing with, okay, well, shouting shut the fuck up, at a Voice for Men's John Hembling made the rounds. Binks was part of a group of fashionista feminists who disrupted a talk on men's issues, finally putting an end to it by pulling the fire alarm. After the video of her went viral, Binks went into full-on victim mode, complaining she had to go into hiding because people were being so mean to her for, among other things, having a good laugh at some guy's suicide. Binks shares more than a superficial resemblance to another piece of work, Rebecca Watson. Deeper than both being degraded copies of the same standard production line hipster douchebag model.
But there are tech solutions. Blogger Rebecca Watson had a bad experience at a conference 2 years ago.
Strange that Mason begins this piece talking about the abuse suffered by high-profile British women. But the only example he presents is the stale old tale of a Brooklyn-based Mrs. Potato Head who spends her every waking moment thinking up ways to make people pay attention to her and then how to make a buck off them. I'm not going to dispute Mason's rehashed version of Elevator Gate, as, again, not a single fuck is given, except to say what turned people against Watson, personal hygiene aside, wasn't her relating the incident itself or her insulting follow-up that suggested the only reason anyone would have to question her is because they can't get laid and need to buy a fleshlight.
There are other tools you can get. Fleshlight, I've heard, is very good. Maybe there are other things you can do. I've heard that you can, like, cut a hole in a watermelon or something. Is that a thing that guys do? I don't know.
What pissed people off was Watson subsequently using her position of power and, dare I say it, privilege to launch unfair strawman attacks on other women such as Steph McGraw, who she used her speaker's position to accuse of being a misogynist sympathizer or some such thing. Here's how Rebecca Watson, Paul Mason's clever substitute for high-profile British women, well, no, not, and nominally, actually works. Rebecca Watson gives a talk on evolutionary psychology. Evolutionary psychology is bad because, according to fashionista feminists, everything is socialization. Biology is not destiny, except when they consider transgender women, who they think are just, well, dudes. What Rebecca Watson proves is that among the long list of topics she knows fuck all about yet feels qualified to trash, one of them is evolutionary psychology. Ed Clint, who knows a thing or two about evolutionary psychology, writes a detailed, devastating critique of her talk that really drives home the point that Rebecca Watson knows fuck all about evolutionary psychology. Rebecca Watson, who credits her understanding of some topics to watching Lifetime original movies, and in another desperate bid for attention, tries to piggyback off the success of the sitcom The Big Bang Theory. She claims, after a drunk and fictional Penny forcefully drags fictional Leonard off to his fictional bedroom to fictionally fuck his fictional brains out, that it was fictional Leonard that was guilty of fictional rape. Unfortunately for Rebecca Watson, fewer people took the bait than she might have liked. Fortunately for her, one of those who took the bait was Ed Clint. He opined that Rebecca Watson's theory of pop culture clickbait was ridiculous, naively adding that he's done the dirty deed when one or both parties had a couple of drinks in them, as has anyone who has had alcohol, sex, or some combination of the two. Rebecca Watson, far too rude to send him a thank you note for this, declares Ed Clint a confessed rapist and does a celebratory chicken dance in the end zone of her own mind. This was the period when all the fashionista feminists and social justice wannabes, plus some cynical assholes trying to get more blog hits or just in general attention, were desperate to get in their rape and sexual assault accusations before all the good high-profile targets in atheism and skepticism had dibs called on them. You see, it went like this.
Anti-harassment policies will take away our fun. Aren't those the exact same arguments they used like in the 70s to try to stop employers from enacting laws like that?
Absolutely.
You know how we always go to work and we're like, man, I wish somebody would slap me on the ass, you know? Yeah, it's the same thing.
They make it sound like they're proposing perfectly sensible and fairly applied harassment policies, and the only people who could object to that were those who feared such policies would cut into their hot sexual harassment action. The problem, of course, wasn't the policy or anything that appeared on paper. The problem was the people proposing the policy who were lining up, as usual, to be the sole arbiter and executor of it. Now, anyone who has been paying attention knew exactly what these clowns were all about and how they operated. Every time they opened their mouths, the air would fairly reek with the stink of capricious interpretation and selective enforcement. Hearing these neurotic whiners and control junkies prattle on about policies after some poor guy was drummed out of attending any more conventions, after a woman observing him using a camera on a monopod to take pictures, made the ad hoc accusation that he was taking upskirt pictures based on nothing but her own febrile imagination. That made any policy sound like the pink frilly despot's version of martial law. No coincidence that, once the ploy of harassment policies fell through by virtue of there being no harassment they could actually point to, that the prophecy fulfilled itself with a slew of accusations.
What is your blog? You're suppressing
echo chamber.
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
Although the usual suspect fashionista feminists and social justice wannabes try to laugh off the idea that they bring much of this on themselves, it strikes me that many of these people might find themselves getting negative reactions for this sort of thing because of their prejudices, which they are totally blind to, and their fixation on their self-interested issues, and more specifically, themselves, which tends to make them just so very fucking annoying. Following Paul Mason's precedent of providing examples by digging up people who have really nothing to do with the subject at hand, I present to you Dr. Pamela Cox, who did a rather interesting BBC Two series on people in service during the late Victorian era, well into the 1920s.
Whereas in the past, finding good servants was the problem. Now, the problem was finding any servant at all, when so many of Britain's young were opting out.
One of the answers to the servant problem was Christian charity. Church-going philanthropists set up hundreds of schemes to rescue the rootless working class and train them to work as servants.
She also loves green apple Jolly Ranchers so much, she carries her stash around her neck. I say rather interesting because although she began with men and women servants, it wasn't long before she went off talking about women almost exclusively, the men apparently having buggered off elsewhere. Working for the middle and professional classes were some servants who had the absolutely thankless title of maid of all work, as they did all the work all the time. Although they were responsible for all the household tasks, and back then there were a whole lot more of that, they began making outrageous demands, such as better pay, better hours, and a half day off on Sundays. Happily for them, they were women doing shit work in Britain and not, say, male miners in the US, whose similar demands were resolved by Pinkertons with machine guns. The problem was the middle and professional class women who were employing them were also suffragettes agitating for women's rights.
Perhaps the most surprising reaction to the servant unions wasn't from the male-dominated labour movement, but from the suffragettes.
Just because they were advocating for their rights in no way meant the suffragettes were going to coddle the lower-class women they employed by giving in to their demands. And don't just think that's old-fashioned thinking, because there's a timeless quality to being a selfish hypocrite.
Yet even though domestic servants were the third largest group of all the women who signed petitions for women's votes, the suffragettes found it difficult to support servants' rights.
I think domestic servants were very active in the movement. They made up probably the bulk of the women who would have clustered around suffrage speakers at street corners. But they're not always duly recognised as members of the women's movement.
How do we explain that?
I think that there are many suffragettes in the women's movement during this period who are middle-class women, who are professional women, and who, of course, employ servants. And they themselves often have a very ambiguous response to their militant maids. So there's a letter here in The Woman Worker from a suffragette mistress who signs herself a working wife.
Oh, yes.
I pay them good wages, they have the same food, the same beds as ourselves. I have nursed the maids when they were ill and sent them away for holidays. I have interested myself in their affairs, helped their friends, sent them to places of amusement and to suffrage meetings. So she feels that she's doing all she can as a progressive feminist mistress to help the women who work in her own home.
And she expects good performance in return.
She does, and she expects them to be grateful, which they're not. So the rest of the letter is her complaining about how they nevertheless continue to shirk their work, how in fact this mistress, who works as a doctor's wife, works much harder than her servants, who she often finds when she comes home from work, lounging about, sitting in front of the fire, having a nice time. So the letter shifts in tone towards the end, and a sort of note of desperation creeps in when this working wife asks, "Please tell me whose fault it all is. Only it's no use saying I ought to take a flat and do all the work myself, as well as my other work and my mothering work. My husband's practice would disappear for one thing, and then we could not live at all."
Sounds like a very modern dilemma.
It is. Even when middle-class women go out to work, someone still needs to do the work of the home. And it's unclear, if it's not servants, who will do that work.
That does present a bit of a problem with cognitive dissonance for Dr. Cox. I mean, she's doing a program on working women, but as a matter of reflex, it's not like she's going to yoke the suffragettes with an accusation of hypocrisy, no matter how obvious that might be. She has a conflict between the interests of women that could be perfectly explained by noting class trumps sisterhood, but that isn't the sort of thing white, educated, bourgeois, privileged, fashionable feminists might want to talk about, even from a historical perspective. There must be a way out of the dilemma. Something has to give. Someone must be wrong.
One thing for sure, it's not going to be the men.
Yeah, men. What a bunch of layabout assholes. When the floors needed scrubbing and the king's horse needed jumping in front of, where were they? Obviously, they had better, cushier man things to do. Dr. Cox resolves a long-dead conflict among women by deploying the good old-fashioned laugh about boys among girls is telling. I don't know what's going on with high-profile British women, at least not from watching Newsnight. But what goes on in the Mean Girls clique of the atheism and skeptic Twitter sphere is like this. Rebecca Watson pulls the hair of Steph McGraw. Melody Hensley spitballs Abby Smith. Amy Roth has a hissy fit over Harriet Hall. Stephanie Zvon throws rocks at Ellen Beth Wachs, and everyone throws shit and tampons at Sarah Mayhew. For all this talk of rape-threatening trolls, most of what we get around these parts is catty girl-on-girl violence without the socially redeeming accessory of a wading pool filled with jello. And the very same women who claim victimhood, the need for blocking and blacklists at their control, or also the perpetrators of all this. So, where does this leave us? We have the promotion of things like the BlockBot as a technical solution to the overwrought clickbait problem of rape and death-threatening trolls, when the BlockBot is nothing of the sort. It's just a tool catering to the needs of passive-aggressive bullies. Rape and death threats. The closest we've come to having that documented, and in a completely piss-poor manner, is Rebecca Watson's much-cited but rarely quoted Page O' Hate, which compiles any and all negative comments about her that she scoured the internet for and passes them off as hate and dire threats. The sheer quantity of the supposed threats are supposed to distract from the quality. That is, they are nothing of the sort. You'd think an outfit like the BBC, if not the tools at Newsnight itself, would have no small interest in promoting free expression, and should be taking the lead in decrying the transparent cliquish neurosis represented by the BlockBot. I don't believe for a moment they fell for James Billingham's con. No one who isn't completely awed by supermarket automatic doors and can, male or female, take a piss without hitting their shoes would fall for that crap. Newsnight, giving them the benefit of the doubt, was just cynically playing along, being in the business of selling clickbait threat narrative nonsense, being in the business of selling shit you don't need. Paul Mason and Newsnight's worst omission is in not making the vested interest of their supposed experts, their sources, perfectly clear. The people spinning this story should be the story. The BlockBot isn't some open-source commons project with transparency for all. It's not the wiki of censorship. It's the atheism plus BlockBot, operated by one of the most malicious and toxic outfits on the internet, Atheism Plus, and the related nightmares of Freethought Blogs, Skeptic, and the Center for Inquiry, all of which are skeptics, atheists, and inquiring freethinkers, only to the same extent that North Korea is a democratic people's republic. Adding people to the BlockBot for any number of neurotic, malicious reasons, and then turning around and claiming only people who make violent or sexually explicit threats are blacklisted, is exactly the sort of dishonest, authoritarian, doublespeak crap that people who know far more about these clowns than Paul Mason and Newsnight have come to expect from the freethought bullies. It's also the reason so much perfectly justified animosity is directed at them in the first place. One has to assume through ignorance, laziness, malice, or worse, that Paul Mason and Newsnight are perfectly fine with these clowns co-opting a piece of Twitter's architecture, without reason, without oversight, without the sense nature-equipped most primates. The BlockBot complaint department tells you everything you need to know. On the BlockBot page itself is a convenient-looking link. Should you have concerns or wish to inquire which of your ill-advised tweets or Twitter followers or forum comments got you added to the blacklist of proud rapists, that link will take you into the heart of the Atheism Plus forum, to the Dealing with Twitter Trolls thread. If you aren't put off by the presumption of guilt, you're just a quick registration away from asking your question. Be warned, though, Just as Atheism Plus dislikes people actually thinking for themselves, they devise a term to describe that aberration as hyper-skepticism, they have no more love for just asking questions, which is dismissed by the revealing sexualized term jacking off, while free speech, not properly vetted and approved, is nothing more than freeze peach. Just by way of example, here's Atheism Plus forum bigwig Xanthi on all those annoying, tedious people coming in to ask questions of all the nerve and who don't have the common courtesy to get their free speech ration card properly stamped and approved.
Jacking off isn't very polite, and quite frankly, many of us are past the point of wanting to devote more attention to these people, which they are not entitled to. Note that phrase. Free speech, freedom of expression doesn't mean the other person must be obliged or coerced into giving you a hearing. In fact, almost every reference I've seen of free speech in these sort of conversations turns out to be completely fallacious. Hence the freeze peach meme. I wouldn't mind an honest dialogue, but the main obstacles of that are the people criticizing this are most often liars, some of whom have bought so heavily into the free speech mantra that they don't even know anymore that they're lying. The arguments offered by these people frequently derail into foolishnesses and arrant silliness. The faux civility argument. I'd like to see an example of someone who hasn't been conducting harassment by egging on the people who do employ abusive or trollish methods. Standing aloof and pretending to be above it all and not taking sides is tacitly supporting harassment by ignoring the fact it does have harmful effects on people. Penis.
Yeah, why would anyone like Paul Mason have a problem with that fly shit in the pepper being in charge of handing out muzzles? If the problem is Twitter trolls, which it isn't, then there's a fine example of a solution that is much, much worse than the problem. You know, Woody Allen, alleged abuser in his own right, said it best in The Front, a film about people silenced and destroyed by a threat narrative witch hunt and blacklist that is still in some people's living memory.
Fellas, I don't recognize the right of this committee. And furthermore, you can all go fuck yourselves.
Fairy tales can come true, it can happen to you. If you're young at heart, for it's hard you will find to be narrow of mind. If you're young at heart, you can go to extremes with impossible schemes. You can laugh when your dreams fall apart at the seams, and life gets more exciting with each passing day. And love is either in your heart or on its way. Don't you know that it's worth every treasure on earth to be young?
Newsnight and Mason in particular. Newsnight and Mason in particular have apparently